and make sure everybody has access who wasn't able to join us tonight. So before we turn the mic over to Dasha, I hope you'll indulge a few words about our organization. Some of you are familiar with us. Since 2004, Shake Rag Alley has existed to provide arts and crafts workshops to adults and youth, cultivate the creativity that thrives in our rural region of southwestern Wisconsin, and steward our campus in the historic heart of Mineral Point, which hopefully you're aware where we are. We're between Dubuque and Madison in southwestern Wisconsin. And since 2011, we've been partnering with Wisconsin writing organizations to offer week-long residencies to their contest winners and the state Poet Laureate. This year, we've been fortunate to be able to welcome winners from the Wisconsin People and Ideas Magazine contest, the Wisconsin Writers Association, as well as our state Poet Laureate. We're grateful to Dasha and all of the writers who have been willing to share an evening with us during their residency, or in some cases with our school youth in the Mineral Point School District. And we're very grateful to those of you who made a donation when you registered for tonight's event. We really appreciate your support. And I'm gonna torture you just a few more minutes with some more Shake Rag Alley-ness. When I have a captive audience, I'm always excited to share the wonderful literary arts programming that we have in store this year. We have upcoming standalone workshops in Pathways to Publication, Family History, Writing from Virtual Images, which is a two-day virtual event, and a poetry workshop in the fall featuring Catherine Young, who's with us tonight, and a wonderfully titled Gathering Gold. And in May, we're going to be hosting our sixth annual three-day Mining the Story writing retreat with workshops focused on memoir, fiction, and research in writing. And the retreat includes, in addition to the workshops, craft talks, panel discussions, open night mics over lunch, an evening faculty and local author reading in town. It's gonna be a really good time. And then we have several free programs that happen monthly. We have our Driftless Poets Workshop that meets, it's a hybrid. It meets in person and via Zoom monthly. And last month we kicked off our first free prose writing workshop, and that's happening virtually until April when it will move on campus. And we're continuing the second year of our anti-racism book club, which is an outgrowth of the NEA big read of Claudia Rankine's Citizen, an American Lyric, which that took place in 2020, and we weren't done talking and having crucial conversations around racism in this country. So in March and April, we will be discussing The Souls of Black Folk by W.E.B. Du Bois. So if you can join us, you'll find information about all of these programs and more on our website. You can sign up for our e-newsletters, which go out twice a month. You can follow us on Facebook and Instagram and request our print catalog if you want to hold it in your hands and see all the good stuff in store this year. So now I'm done talking, except to introduce our 2021-22 Wisconsin State Poet Laureate, Dasha Kelly Hamilton, who is in residence in Mineral Point this week. Dasha is a writer, performance artist, and creative change agent, applying the creative process to facilitate dialogues around human and social wellness. She is the author of two novels, three poetry collections, four spoken word albums, and one collection of personal vignettes. She's taught at colleges, conferences, and classrooms, curated fellowships for emerging leaders. She's been an arts envoy for the US Embassy, facilitating community building initiatives in Botswana, Toronto, Mauritius, Beirut. Her touring production, Make and Cake, uniquely engages communities in a forward dialogue on race, class, and equity. Dasha's a National Rubinger Fellow, and concurrently, as well as being state Poet Laureate, she is the Poet Laureate for the city of Milwaukee. So without further ado, please join me in welcoming Dasha to tonight's program.
Hello, good people. Hello, good people. So much we're gonna do. I'm gonna get into some words and then hear your words and do some more words. It's gonna be a whole experience. We're gonna have a spectacle today. But long ago, I set out on a road less traveled. I had one small bag packed tight of 31 flavors of canned courage, 2 watery bottles of faith, a nail file, a flashlight, a pocket full of hot tamales, and this charm bracelet tinkling out sterling silver melodies to remind me of home while I roamed in search of my own 7 wonders. And I had to plunge into deep oceans, lapping the circumference of myself. But as I picked my body up and pulled myself to shore, I stretched out the strips of my unwinding latitude from left to right. Then I traversed myself and worked on getting my longitude tight. And as I walked, I learned to revel in every 1-2 step. 1-2 step. I kept going, dragging my knuckles along my own equator until I was fully evolved, walking where I once crawled. Then I stabbed a flag into this hardened earth and declared a victory over this journey. And then you came along. You came along and tried to steer my destiny onto your path. You, someone who's never even tested the limits of your own resolve. You've never set your feet into quick cementing dreams. You never stripped your soul naked, twisting and gyrating into the lap of fate, hoping you must arouse the possibility of your deepest desired dreams. And it seems that you don't understand why I don't want to live like you. I don't want to live like you, so afraid of my own life shadow that I keep my back pressed against stone walls and hide from the brilliance of the sun. I don't even want to live near you on your corner of half-ass boulevard and complacency street. On the city's other side, I reside where creativity and confidence meet. And I know that was you coming around my side of town trying to drag red herring bones across the trails to my success, thinking I might trip on the bones that you left. And I know that was you trying to brush the breadcrumbs away from my appointed path, thinking I might lose my way or my direction. Ooh, you make me laugh. Because you don't seem to understand, I am constructed to live among the stars. My body, it's infused with cosmically pliable bars that allow me to infinitely expand. I irrefutably command my dominion over any given space, multiplying myself so that my bows and buttocks will displace entire galaxies, crowd distant suns, weave my likeness into starry splatter until my spirit and the universe become one and the same. Then I train the crosshairs of my ambition to fire quasars, shooting stars, hunting big game dreams while mounting big time reality. See, I hunt hungrily with Orion's bow because I was taught to get out and go and get mine. And some days I lose. Some days I win. In either event, at the end of the day, I count up my bounty and my blessings, giving praises where it's due. Then I sink my weary body into the curve of a crescent moon, swinging my feet through the atmosphere, all the while looking down at you. Looking down at you while you hurl your faithless prayers against the night. You're calling out the constellations through clenched teeth. And even though you never called on me, I'm the one sprinkling that stardust upon your crown. I'm the one trying to push you on, even though you tried to knock me down. Because from up here, I breathe in the thin air of compassion. And it's easier for me to see that it's really not your fault. You just never learned to walk like me. Hello, good people. How are we? How are we? How are we? Welcome to my world. Welcome to my world. I wanted to share that was one of the pieces that started my, I guess, public journey as a poet. Prior to that, I didn't quite know that the things that I was writing already counted as poems. I don't think I'm the only one. Had to break through the forms and formulas and the rules of who said poems were what. And that was also the beginning of me doing spoken word and being a part of an incredible community within Milwaukee, across the state, throughout the Midwest, and ultimately nationally, of other not quite sure they knew that they were poets, absolutely learned that they were powerful poets, sharing their words on stages in competition. And it's also gave me the comfort, because I won't say confidence. No one's going to be surprised that I was that kid who raised her hand all the time. I was the one who wasn't afraid to speak in front of people. This has been me since I was five. So that part wasn't the confidence of speaking in front of people, but being comfortable that the story that I had to share was a story that needed to be shared, different from the poems I was supposed to be writing, different from the way they were supposed to rhyme or not, and whether they should be in form and such. It was a permission for me to navigate this narrative of myself by sharing narratives with each other. So that has been my relationship to poetry. I came to it quite late, but my relationship with words has been ever since I was a kid. So we're gonna have some fun. I'm gonna share with you. I called it a Dasha sampler of sorts. So it was, I'll share some poems. We're gonna write a little bit. I'm gonna give you updates on the projects I'm working on. I like to say I have pretty wide lanes. I'm a creative change agent because just settling on one thing was too hard. I'm a poet. I'm an author, I'm an educator, I'm a facilitator, I'm a culture creator, I'm an organizer, I'm all these things. And they all are to the desire of using the tiny, enormous toolkit that I have to do my tiny, enormous part towards human wellness, towards social change. And I found that my tiny, enormous toolkit is using creativity as a way to get us in rooms, Zoom or otherwise, to listen to each other, to strengthen our muscles of listening and being heard and having some fun and laughs along the way. So I'm gonna take you through some parts of that journey by sharing some work and getting us moving together. Sounds good? I love a captive audience. You have to say yes, this is great. All right, so. I got organized and everything. So now I'm just double checking that I have everything in order the way I wanted it. Yes. My name means not quite blue, not quite green, not quite Russian, not quite Slavic. Dasha is chartreuse and teal. My name means two shades left of familiar. My name bursts fresh against tongues and norms. Its aberration of letters stamp revenge against persistent voids of personalized pencils, t-shirts, gift shop keychains, and bicycle license plates. My name means black girl who's never black enough. Voluptuous girl who learned to strap her curves into restraints. My name means determined, inventive, and handicapped with stubborn hopefulness. My name suggests the existence of mystical things, of purgatory, of unicorns, of miracles after the storm. My name is a compromise between a princess and a queen, between a lady in waiting and a rising king, between the second and third dip beneath placid waters. My name means truce, means promise, means recycled new beginnings. My name means benefit of the doubt. It means more to do. It means more to come. It means more than its weight in gold. It means more. It means more. It means more. This is one of my favorite workshops that I do in going into the schools. And when I initially started going into schools, I realized it was an opportunity, not so much about teaching poetry, although of course that's what happened, but inviting young people and soon not so young people into their own selves. And starting with something as simple as making a list and then choosing your favorite things on that list. And then voila, you already have a poem. So the students were always pleased to know that just by following my instructions for 3 minutes, they were already poets. And then rearranging that language and adding more of the story. It invited them to realize that, like I had to, there are a jillion ways to make a poem a poem. Secondly, let them know that everything about them, even the fact that they like to have mixed match socks, is a detail that is worthy of a poem and story and language. And it gave them the sense that we have made poetry feel like magic. I mean, it is magic, but hold on. It's magic when it's done and we all hold it. And again, most of us are told, or suggested, or we feel that there's a special brew cast construction of human that could create a poem. And I like to make it my mission to tell people that they are already poets and poems. So having exercise like this, where you take folks through putting together language and giving them permission to see what's in front of them as the beginning of a poem, they see themselves as art too. So I'm going to ask you to warm this chat thread. What does your name mean? Not to be confused with Marilyn Monroe. Yes, I appreciate this. This is perfect. So far, Mary and Laura. Part of the session in this workshop is I asked the students, listen, so what one, if you know what your name means by a definition or a ceremony, definitely. And for those who are in my tribe who don't know what your name means, why? You didn't think about it. The adults never agreed on it. You don't know which language to go to, or you just never looked it up. And that's a story too. And then the next question we ask, well, what's the relationship? Well, my name, there were seven Mikes. So we had to be Mike M and Mike T and Mike R. Or I don't know how I got named after this person. Or I don't know why that person got this honor. My name has too many letters. My name isn't fancy enough. My relationship with my name has always been the fact that no one had it. And I didn't appreciate that until I was an adult. So I had a nickname in high school, the whole deal. So at the end of this session, I love these things that are coming in. Thank you. Is the note that you had two people who didn't even know you, name you. I mean, I know. They had hopes and they had a vision and they were hopefully intentful with the name that they laid across your life. But it's your life that determines what your name really means, right? Just like a Nike, a brand, what does it mean? What does your name evoke before you walk into a room, after you leave a room? How it sounds to yourself when you hear it, when you speak it. That's what your name means. And again, particularly working with young people, it was always a magical experience to see them have that little pop of fresh ideas about something as everyday and never ordinary as their name. And my favorite story, there was a student I was teaching in Miami, and the poem he wrote was describing, he wasn't sure if the humps of the M, his name is Michael, the humps of the M were too peaked or too round, did he have the dot high enough or was it too low? And he was comparing his signature to his father's. And in describing how he signs his name became his poem that he worked through about what it meant for him to be a junior, the pressure of it, the inspiration of it, which I don't know if you thought about before at 15. But it was wonderful to have them work through that, and poems give us a space to do that. So that's the approach that I've taken, the gift to me of being able to do this work. I mentioned going into classrooms, I figured out immediately that my purpose in this room of third graders is to get them excited about their ideas, to get them to celebrate how brilliant they already are, especially that kid in the back with the desk by the supply closet
the one who's not allowed to sit with the other students because he talks too much, because she can't keep her hands to herself, because he's not good at math, because they don't know how to, that student. On this day where they're invited to be creative and scribble poems, which means you get to break all the rules, on that day, they're brilliant. And they're part of their class community. Fast forward to having that same experience in going into institutions of higher learning, into correctional institutions, into any box place where a human's not sure where they fit in. I love that I've been able to craft this path, this practice of using the process of going from to writing a poem to give them the space to imagine. And that's a muscle that you don't realize you have strengthened until you don't realize you don't have it, if that makes sense. So I learned that that was my task, not to teach poems, but to use poems as a way to teach imagination. And fast forward now, goodness gracious, 25 years. Yes, I'm still in love with poetry and fiction and teaching and coordinating, but I'm really clear that the opportunity is shifting how we think, shifting what we think about creativity, shifting how we talk about the arts, shifting the way that we find ways to fall in conversations with each other. So these poems and this fiction and fairy tales are tools, they are weapons, they are protection, and they're absolutely entertainment most days. So let me go through some of these things. My name, Justin, I like it, means woman, child, teacher. And the idea of thinking of you live up to your name, and who put that on us, right? Means gringo when I'm in the South, when I'm in South America, fundraiser when I'm at work, an actress who used to be famous when I asked my mother, wise woman in progress when I look at my dreams. Julie, you're my favorite right now. Wonderful. Megan, my grandma was emphatic that the H makes it an Irish spelling. You cannot argue with grandmas. My middle name is Nanette. I wasn't exactly sure how to spell it until I was probably 7, because my grandmother insisted it had 2 N's. My mother said it had 1. I let them work it out and I just stuck with the letters that I knew pretty well. All right, so let me share something else with you. Form. Every man I've loved, from daddy to my husband, has also loved basketball. To their collective dismay, I never took to the game. Watching, for me, isn't dissimilar to gazing at darting colors in an aquarium. I did play 1 game, however, 3rd grade. I presume we lost, since I only recall coach's red face and pulsing neck. I'd been trailing dizzy circles behind the swarm of players. I thought you knew how to play, he bellowed, benching me. Actually, I'd come that day to register. Maybe he put me in because I looked like a championship trophy. Maybe I lied because I believed I could be shiny too. Look at me, my strand. Look at me following my list. Undersides. Nope, wrong. Don't pat yourself in the back too fast, people. Slick. The lunchroom vibrated its regular din. I was a freshman. Goofy, but played sports. Honors classes, but knew the lyrics to Run DMC. Okay, most of them. And I had some dance moves. He was a senior with more work hours than classes, more pressed slacks with dress shoes, and had all the dance moves. I'd witnessed his pop block devour the boys from K-Town. Sniffling, I balanced my lunch tray, waiting. He emerged in an apron, hairnet, maroon shoes gleaming. As planned, I lowered my tray, met his eyes. Unplanned, the slick escaping my right nostril. Fleeing became my new dance move. So these little tiny little snippets I'm sharing, these poetic stories, are my dashnets. And there are 100 words exactly. They're tiny little vignettes, memories from my world, pieces that I found didn't stretch into an essay. I would have really been working hard to make them into an epic poem, but again, still worthy of words. And I love the experience, the process of editing. So for me, it was a chance to take this much story and figure out how to put it into this much space. And had an incredible opportunity to do a workshop at the Kohler Arts Center last fall. And so it was a series that we had, and people were taking them through how to write tiny little stories the same way. And then as part of the project, we had those little excerpts published. So Life in Short is my published collection of 100 of my favorite little pieces. And I've took off this last year, and I'm in the process now of finishing up an arsenal of new Doshnets. So if anyone who's on my email list, you didn't get kicked off, I've been a little consumed with a wonderful world, but they are coming back. And if you would like to have these, just know that I send them to people in their inbox to email. So I appreciate the feedback. People say, oh, it's a little breath of fresh air in between the bills and the meeting requests, and it takes a minute to read. So again, they're all 100 words each. You can sign up at my website, dashakelly.com. And I'll put that in the chat before we get out of here too. We're rocking and rolling. I'm really proud of myself right now. All right. So I would like to point your attention. Thank you, Sarah. Put your attention to, this prompt. Every distance seemed like an opening. And this is little logo is alignment. So as your state poet laureate, my initiative is called Alignment, and it's a statewide poetry exchange. And so what happens is there are 12 prompts, and all the prompts like this are a line of poetry. And these lines of poetry come from my predecessor's collection. Margaret Rosga has a book called Through This Door. So I went through and I found 12 poems and pulled 12 lines like this. And the invitation is for you to decide what this line means. Exactly, you don't know. So we want to get in and analyze the poem, or you see the poem and you can't help but kind of respond to it. Again, for seasoned poets, we can work through that. For the folks who don't know they're already poets, just remind them it always starts with an idea. It starts with a story. It starts with a moment, and we go from there. So whatever this moment is you think of, I would invite you, what does this make you think of? Please drop that in the chat. Every distance seemed like an opening. And in my sessions with my Munchkin students, with my incarcerated writers, with executives who are doing a retreat, they love to hear that there are no wrong answers. And all of us already love words, but even those of us who are skilled, who have this relationship with language, we still find ourselves wondering if our idea is okay, if this whittling of language is gonna be received well. And it's part of the gift and curse of being a creative, the gift and curse of being in tune with this idea of art. But if you don't already know that you're good, that uncertainty can be terrifying. So to tell them there's are no wrong answers opens up the door for people to imagine. So every distance seemed like an opening. That every struggle is filled with possibility, yes. Oh, I love that, Julie. Yes, it's hard to really know another person. I have this, I don't even remember I found it, heard it, but it's a simple statement that feels really deep if you just pause. You never know what the other person is thinking. I know. Seems basic. How profound is that? But pause. You never know what the other person is thinking, from what they're going through, from how they see you, from what they're excited about, from what they know, whether or not we've decided they're helpful or worthy for us, we just don't know. There's everyone you meet every single human that you meet and see knows something that you don't. A bunch of somethings. So we can't dismiss people so quickly. I know. We're working through it, humans. We're going to get better. So let me see what else we have. Opportunities exist, pauses, spaces, the unexpected. Hiking next to a mountain opens up the possibility that a wild animal might pounce. My recent fear, and oh, this sounds too real, Laura. That's why I only hike on sidewalks. Borders, when unblocked, can be opportunities to move, grow, and to flee. Ashe. Optimism, a possibility. This reminds me of the blues lyrics, "Dust my broom," that hitting the road, hoboing, is perhaps a new opportunity in a maze. Don't be afraid to reach out physically or in your words. Oh my goodness, you are killing it. So we're going to come back to this list. I'm going to show you something first. So when you go to alignment.org, you'll sign in, you'll make a poetic license. Ah! And then once you put your poem in, you will then have access to, oh, you know what? I'm showing this like you can see it. I'm sorry. Hold on a second. Let me share my screen. There we go. Rewind. When you go to alignment.org, you will go to your sign up, you'll make a poetic license, you'll see the list of prompts, and we have a new slate that will come out in April. So there'll be a new slate of prompts every 6 months. So looking at every distance seems like an opening. Once you submit your poem, you'll have access to all the poems that were submitted across the state. And at the end of each month, you'll be invited to let us know what your favorites were. And those favorites will get presented for people that come back and look at the archives. I think I'm doing this right. Nope, those are all still voting. Where'd they go? Okay, my poems got moved. Hold on. But you'll be able to go back and choose and have the votes. And the best part is, once you put your poem in, you'll receive a poem from someone else in the state who wrote to that same prompt. So it'll be, if it's digital, come in your email, you'll get a notification, and you'll have this little folder in this site where you'll be able to continue to peruse and have a conversation of sorts. Now, it's not a pen pal, so you're not gonna be exchanging back and forth. So people are like, oh my goodness, I'm about to write. No, just one poem. And that one poem, for the 3 to 4 months, you'll get a little poem from someone new at the end of the month. So the more prompts you participate, the more poetic love will come into your inbox. And here's my favorite part. This has been designed in a way that our incarcerated writers are also able to participate. So of all of the outreach that I've done, going into prisons has been my most fulfilling. And yes, we all know I love the babies, but going into working with folks who are rediscovering their voices, who are in the process of recalibrating and reimagining who they are allowed to be. And we make this little safe space in the library, in the gym, in the classroom, and they built this community. So I was first invited into Racine Correctional over 15 years ago. And initially it was come into a workshop and do a performance. And I said, sure, I'll come in, I'll talk about slam, I'll do a session, and we'll do a reading together that evening. And immediately the men took to it, and we left that day with a whole new program where they got together and they met every 2 weeks. They self-monitored, they came up with their own curriculum, they held each other accountable for due dates, they hosted events. And I tried to go as often as I could. Some years I went every month, some years I went 4 times, but every Christmas we have the big house holiday show. So I would say, hey, Sarah, can you come read me 5 minutes of poetry? Hey, Carmen, can you come and dance for 5 minutes? Can you come play some music? Can I get some comedy? We loaded up on a yellow school bus and we were a USO show. And then we are co-presenting with these men. And I don't not go to women's prisons. They just haven't asked me back in a while. I don't know what that's about, but that's okay. So I call them my fellas. And now we co-host the show. we literally sell out the entire auditorium. The last year we were scheduled to go before the pandemic, we weren't able to, and this is a proud reason, because the institution had to choose between us, our show, and the Bucks, because apparently that's too much excitement in 1 week. Don't get me started. But to know that we have elevated to that's a decision between this collective spoken word experience and world championship athletics, I think that's a win for poetry. And of all of the, and knowing how the safe space is created, knowing the outlet that it offers, and to have an opportunity to have them continue to be to participate. So yes, they don't have access to the internet. So how does that work? We have volunteers in place to type up their handwritten poems that they're able to mail in. We've been in dialogue with the DOC to coordinate classes, partnering with writers and writing organizations to deliver virtual workshops. So we're in dialogue about including this work with education in prisons. So there's a lot of things in the mix, but I was having a conversation with Sarah yesterday. Dasha, just do one thing right now. Just do one thing right now. And so we all have habits of engagement that we have the opportunity to I don't say be better, but reevaluate. So one thing at a time, not 20, but I have 20 things on my piece of paper. So I've got some time to get to all of those. So that is the alignment project. And I certainly hope that you take that down, that you will participate. I want to share. I know, Marilyn, I have so many words. I try not to, but I just do. I just do. So at the end of each month, we make a little collaborative poem. Okay.
Every distance seems like an opening. I walk out into the deep water, and still voices are circling around to bind us all to the place where stars are born. You are the distance that allowed us to become more intimate. Did you know you helped write the music for these words and will always be there? Can we not share space, brave the elements, caressed by the sun's last light touch, blue-gray with hues, maximizing my potential because life is such a bumpy road. If only we had known. A canvas of ocean and song. I stole the night, singing a beautiful creation, sandpipers poke and probe, showing me a close to the day, a mural of cosmic mysteries rising to breath. Your gunmetal shades lay there too, salty charm and grief speak, the small grains of stories we told ourselves, the plink of the wind chime, and all who sink to the vastness of its depths.
A canvas of ocean.
So this is the part where you scribble. Every distance seemed like an opening. You already have the idea started. I'm gonna do a timed write. So just keep the pen moving, whether it's a poem or it's a journal entry or just a free write. At this moment, just let it flow, and then we can mold it into what it could be later, or this just might be something to get your pen some exercise. So if you can position yourself with your pen or have your extra another tab open. Ready? Go. Find a comfortable place where you can come to a stop soon. Find the end of your thought. All right. I'd like for you to take just a moment to skim what you wrote and find one phrase or line that you like and put that in the thread. We're gonna have a moment. All right, let's see what we have. Every distance seemed like an opening. Waters ebb and flow, I stand knee deep. We must remember to move on to the next beginning, coming together at a point that I could squeeze through. I thought I could fill in the gaps where the edge did not meet, but oozed opportunities. Days spent straightening to get steps, to think without tripping over random misplacements by loved ones. The road just got wider into the light, putting distance between you and me forever. Borders that to some look like mountains, for others are invitations to escape this now. In a bookshelf of my favorite books, as if someone was taking them from me. Angels flutter all around her head, and hummingbirds too, with impossible long beaks to sill, sucking the juice. Look at y'all, 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 look at y'all. So you can see I have get an immense amount of joy from this project, and the site will be evergreen in that it will exist beyond my term, and it's set where it will continue to feed us poems and unexpected connections and a reminder that there are people in those buildings. Some of them actually write poems. Yeah, many of them did things to get placed in those buildings, but there are people in those buildings. And anyone who writes a poem, we can definitely reconsider those people in those buildings. All right. Ba-ba-bum, cruising along. Undersides. Che waits patiently at the edges of my imagination. We found one another a few years ago and have been stoking our mutual interest along the way. We arranged to steal away one Sunday morning to the upstairs writing chair. She was to show me all the memories gnawing at her undersides. Mission met me there instead. New character, new story. I found her collapsed against a wall, watching the curtain shears breathe. She was hiding from death, or celebrating it. I'll know once we figure out who the dead boy, man, turns out to be. Along my periphery, Shay sits with her long legs crossed. She's deciding, hopefully, to tell me her everything. And that is definitely dedicated to folks who have characters. We are living in our heads. They become real. They talk to us. They nudge us with their elbow. They tell us what to write. And that's not what I meant. And don't you dare make that. And it's a relationship. So I started writing fiction. So I've been writing since I was 9 years old. I've loved short stories. And I didn't fall into my own poetic pen until I was in my 20s, but I've been in love with words and crafting them and seeing what they do and how long words match against short words, how big, chunky, fancy words sound in the middle of a silly conversation. So I've been in love with this crafting part for a long time. And so admittedly, fiction is my first love. I love all the words, like you love all your children. So I definitely wanted to share some of my long form as well. So Shay and I, we've been in this relationship. She's a character from a book that's I've been working on, like most of us, forever, called Baker's Dozen. So I'm going to give you, yeah, that's too much. When you were a kid, before you understood that what your body was trying to process beneath its skin, your imagination would race ahead to limbs like gnarled tree roots and wheelchairs and telethons, like the ones you watched with Lady every year. She would hum and hallelujah at the donations and praise the Lord at the caller's stories. You liked watching the performances and interviews and being around Lady on the days she wore her satin slippers. Satin slipper days would involve deep conditioners and face masks, a stack of magazines, catalogs, or an Angela Bassett DVD marathon. Satin slipper days would always include the whole pill. On regular days, Lady would have the oval pills with a straight razor in her bathroom vanity. You'd seen how half the pill could soften her shoulders and lessen the cinch of a reprimand by the time she drained the glass of water. On satin slipper days, Lady floated herself an island, away from luncheons and conventions, salon appointments and Spanx, the sanctified and the sycophants. She would hum bouncy tunes and stroll to the kitchen for more tea. You can still hear the whisk of her slippers across the kitchen tile. When you were small and new, you learned to puzzle and color in the room corner, keeping Lady in your sights and yourself just outside of her periphery. She'd forgotten you were in the house once, still adjusting to your permanence. You'd edged into the hallway after a nap and Lady startled, dropping her mug of tea. In those first few weeks after you were scooped from the church balcony, you nested regularly in Lady's lap. As you'd climb down, Lady would inspect herself for wrinkles or crumbs and then tap the tip of your nose with her slim finger. You didn't make Lady happy the way you could feel your mama's joy when she looked at you, but you could tell Lady wanted to hold you more than she wanted to dress for tea, speak at a luncheon, or hold court for the incessant griping and gossip of church leadership and members. Mama's lap had always been soft, always warm, always open for you. Even if she was busy drawing circles around newspaper ads or scrolling her numbers to make another call about a place to stay, you had a cozy pocket in the plush of her center. You didn't have to be still or careful in Mama's lap, but you did have to be quiet. It was the sweet spot for her little sweet spot, she would say. You'd nap against her chest with your small limbs wrapped around her torso while she wrote new lists on a yellow notepad. You'd lay your head in her lap as she talked in her phone voice about jobs she never had, transportation she couldn't afford, and a mailing address that actually belonged to a bookstore cafe. You'd been afraid of the manager at first, the steep slope of her shoulders, the cool of her steel blue eyes. Mama told you how mean people can wear nice smiles, and sometimes a nice person can have a mean-looking face. The cafe manager would open on snowy mornings without hugs or sugary words and let you both stay as long as you needed. She brought you hot chocolate without you having to ask and said your name when she said goodbye. You told Pat Lady and Pastor your whole name that day. And by the time the usher brought you to church, Mama had shown you how. Okay. We're doing amazing. We're going to have a moment. Whatever time, 8 o'clock. Perfect. Talk about that. I did that. I covered those pieces. Awesome sauce.
Laureate is using cake as a way to move the conversation on class and the state's poet laureate is using cake as a way to move the conversation on class and race in America. Shannon Sims sat down with Dasha Kelly Hamilton to talk about her new one-woman show that centers around a sweet treat. Can't wait to hear this, Shannon.
That's right, Steve. On the stage here at the Rep, Dasha Kelly Hamilton is using the history and our love of cake to get us to rather talk with one another rather than at one another.
We've always had cake. Cake just wasn't always possible.
Who doesn't love cake? But have you ever thought about how it came to be? In a one-woman show, Wisconsin's poet laureate Dasha Kelly Hamilton serves up the history of this sweet treat.
We were still working through some relationship issues.
Layer upon layer, some bitter, some sweet. She shares how class and race in America evolved through this confectionery treat.
What do you want the audience to take away from this experience?
Hopefully, people will walk away and realize that this story of race and class and institutional, all the isms, is built into everything, even the cake that we share. And secondly, I want them to walk away rethinking what they think they know.
The monologue may stop when the curtain goes down, but that's when the complex dialogue starts between audience members, of course, over a slice of cake.
It's a complex conversation. It doesn't have to be painful. Now, there is pain in it, but the what do I do now, I think that's what gets people most nervous. And we have people that we're inviting from the community to help move those conversations forward. So we're not sending people out with just cake and no tools to keep the conversations going.
You are taking this on a tour nationally.
Yes.
Dasha Kelly Hamilton hopes her production will hit that sweet spot and give audience members the courage to better understand who and how we see each other.
We hold on to an ideal because it's comfortable. Regardless of your background, your skin color, your social economic status, we all have to figure out how our story is real.
So you may have seen some other cameras in that showcase there. That's because Dasha Kelly is taking this performance to the documentary stage. So we'll definitely keep you posted there. As I said, it is going on a national tour. The next time it'll be back here in the state of Wisconsin will be in February in Stevens Point and more closer, Madison. Reporting in Milwaukee, Shannon Sims, TMJ4 News.
Whatever it takes to get people talking. Shannon, thank you.
I love this show. I absolutely love this show. And the dates, of course, not of course, but Ami Rona canceled those dates. So we were able to have performances at in Eau Claire at the Pablo Center and at UW Green Bay. And all of the tour dates that we had have been pushed into next season. And I'm excited to report that Wisconsin's going to go everywhere. So James Madison University will be at Penn State. We're going to be in We're doing this for a while. I have dates in Georgia in 2024 already. And you did see that there are two bakers making cakes on stage live, and there's projected media and I'm telling stories. And the basic through line is that cake, the basic ingredients are hard to come by. Once upon a time, you had to be rich to afford sugar. You needed 4 days to make time to bake a cake. And at the time when we were able to everyone make a cake,
was in the same window of time that the United States was becoming the United States and putting into place all of its institutional and systemic policies of race, class, and separatism. And we talk about cake. And at the end of it, we file out of the, as an audience and we have cake together and talk about what we heard. I lead a dialogue. People talk with each other. And I'm really excited about what it's doing and what it's going to do. So as soon as the world continues to melt a little bit more, I'll be excited to give you continued updates on where these slices are going. But we are going to have a moment as well. So I'm going to take you through, and I'm giving you a fair warning. This is typically a 90-minute experience, and we're going to do it in like 6 minutes. I know. I promise it's going to go. It's going to work okay. Because a piece of it was how this all started is that the Kohler Arts Center, I've mentioned them a couple of times. We are absolutely family now. They invited me to come and create an engagement in Sheboygan. I said, listen, we've heard you speak twice now, and we're ready for you to come to Sheboygan and guide us through talking about race. Okay. So came up with an engagement, and we went to six different community groups. And it's something I came up with to get people unexpectedly and authentically talking. And I'll tell you what happened with that, how that connected to the show. But first, I am going to ask you all to take out another scrap of paper. And I'm putting into the chat four animals. And again, with the larger experience, we're doing this more together, but in the interest of time, just trust me. I'm not cheating you, but I'm getting us there. All right. Tiger, otter, goose, spider. What? From each of these animals, choose one feature to make a whole new animal. I know you didn't sign up for art class, but let me show you how much this is not an art class. Just for. You see that? And we're not, so no one can see your paper anyway, but please take a crack at it. I chose the stripes and the fur of the tiger, the shape of an otter. Guess who did not pay attention in natural science class? All the eyes of the spider with lashes, and then the duck tail. But I also wanted to cheat and give the tiger tail too, because guess what? It's my animal. So you please take the same liberties, give you a minute to have fun with that. If you have colored markers on your desk, absolutely. Gift yourself your fifth grade joy, five-year-old joy. Well, I was still coloring in fifth grade, so don't mind me. I like it, Julie. I like it, Julie. So So I'm going to ask you a couple of questions. You can write it right on the piece of paper. If you're still doodling, keep doodling. We're going to multitask this thing together. Where was your creature discovered? Where was it discovered? What does your critter eat? Dreams? Last bite only? The first bite of someone else's plate? I don't know. What's your critter? What do they eat? New socks? That's where the missing sock in the dryer goes? Cake. Yes, Brenda. And how does your critter protect itself? Does it shrink to a marble size? Does it emit a funky odor? Sarcasm. Scrambles the Wi-Fi code. I don't know. How does your critter protect itself? And what do people desire your critter for? Like, is it good luck on a first date? Does it have the last Powerball number for its claws or for its feathers, for making your lovers be honest? Or maybe nobody desires your critter because it makes your lovers be honest. I don't know, it's your critter. And lastly, how long does your critter live? And you can put a number. Or maybe your creature lives until Game of Thrones comes back. Maybe it lives until that person apologizes. Until the quart of ice cream is gone. 10 minutes after you expire, again, or 100 years. How long does your critter live? Y'all get ready. We're about to do a thing. I'm going to put you into groups. And in these groups, I'd like for you to please negotiate a food chain. And when you're done, you can come back into the space. Oop, I almost closed this whole event, Sarah. Wrong button, sorry. Oh wait, it's supposed to just put you in the stuff. I did it wrong. Okay, let's try this again. Assign automatically. Yeah, that's what it did. Clearly not. Is there a message popping up for you to join a group? Okay, good. Do that, please.
I think I'm not in a group because I'm a host, and somehow Marilyn isn't. There are two people not in
a group. Oh, I see what happened. Let's
Oh, and Laura.
We'll be a group.
Okay. Oh. There's a
Oh, she's back.
I don't think she meant to leave. Okay, Mary's back.
We're going to figure out how to put you in a room.
Sorry about that.
Or let's do the, you know what? Hold one second. I also have you on the wrong audio speakers. Oh, that's why I can't hear you. All right. So I will use the little critter that I had as an example. And I'll just listen to you two. Let's see what you're, let's see your critters and let's figure out who's, what's the food chain.
Mary, did you do a critter?
Yeah, so the three of you, and I'm just pretend like I'm not here.
Okay.
Well, that's easy.
Mary, what was your critter?
So, you want to see it, actually?
Sure.
Yeah, it's going to be, it's really small, though. I don't think you can see it.
I
so
see.
I took the legs of the spider, the tail of the otter, the neck of the goose, and the eyes of the tiger.
Okay. And I had legs of the spider, the body of the otter, wings of the goose, and tail of the tiger.
Okay.
I don't know. Marilyn, did you want to share what your critter is?
Oh, sure. I wrote a poem about all of them.
Oh.
Here it is. I own the land. I seek only comfort in my striped mate. We hold hands in the float of water so as not to drift apart. We cannot leave the season when winter's water is open, cannot fly south, but can walk on the water's surface, 8 of our feet spanning existence. So the goose is in there and they're all in there. No.
All right. And I'm going to see if Amy, are you with us, Amy? Did you want to share your critter?
I wasn't sure what the assignment was, but I have.
Yeah, go ahead.
I mean, I did the assignment, but I wasn't sure what we were supposed to do in the breakout rooms.
So we're basically deciding which of these, which aspects of our critters get to stay, and basically like what's the, or which critter deserves to, is part of the food chain. Like, is my critter going to eat Mary's critter and that sort of thing?
Okay. So my critter is discovered in the basement, eats small insects, protects itself by running fast. It's loved for its cute looks and soft feathers. It's the body of a goose, the legs of a spider, the stripes of a tiger, and the face of an otter.
There you go.
That's awesome.
And it's really small, and it runs around the basement.
How long does it live?
Probably a week.
See, I think to me, that's like the first thing, like, to define survival is which one is going to live the longest.
Mm-hmm.
So yours is a week. Mary, how long is yours?
Mine lives until the Packers win the Super Bowl.
Oh. All right.
It's going to be a long time.
I think your critter probably wins. Mine lives until the sun goes down. So that's not going to make the cut. So I think Mary, yours is the winner. And we've got other people back now. Justin, Catherine, and Kevin, were you guys in a group? And whose critter survived? Who's the winning critter for you guys?
Well, we decided to make it ecological so they all work with one another.
Mm.
Now, instead of a chain like a ladder or something, it seems like they all need something from one another. So we worked it out.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, like a circle.
Yeah.
A circle of light.
Oh.
Very nice.
A circle of light.
Hello.
I have to show you guys my critter if you can see it. I don't know how to draw an otter. I just have to, I'm not an artist at all, but I just had to share that because I think it's hilarious.
I want to see more of it, or I want to hear what it is. So it's got a striped tail. And what does it have from the goose?
The wings, which shoot lasers. That's how it defends itself. Lasers from its wings. It's the otter's body and head, and then the spider legs, tiger tail.
Spider, wow, that's great. Can I tell you the defense of my critter? It has a lot of eyes, right? Because it happened to have, like Dasha's, it has a lot of eyes. And when it needs to defend itself, it looks at you sadly and causes you, looks at you sadly and makes you realize that you need to change your behavior.
Yay. That's great.
That's fantastic. Justin, what was yours?
Actually, I had to take a phone call at one point and I had missed.
And Kevin,
I was thinking this is only going to.
Oh, sorry, Justin.
No, go ahead.
Kevin, you were showing us your critter too. What was yours?
It's like a combination of an otter, a tiger, and a spider, but I was trying to get the fact that the spider can cling to any surface, but it's still smooth and fluid like an otter, but then it's got strength of the tiger, and that's the spring underneath, sending it up into the atmosphere.
Uh-huh.
So it was a fun process trying to draw something that was fluid and still had eight legs like a spider.
Yep. Very nice. Okay.
And it's up in the clouds.
Ah.
Does it ever come down, Kevin?
It must if it's also part otter, I guess, but it's very, very fluid and smooth. So got to find something to be so effortless in, like air and water, I think.
You guys are doing the great. The other groups are clearly in some fierce negotiations right now.
Well, there was a timer going in the corner of my breakout room, and I can see how people might think, oh, we've got to work till the end of this time.
Oh.
But Catherine led us quickly through an interesting exercise and discovery.
Welcome back. We have one more group that's working it out. I think they all bought a union rep maybe, because they're going through it right now. And to your point, thank you, Kevin's that comment, same thought. I sent a note to all the groups that were still in session so they wouldn't think they had to stay the whole time, let them know to come back when they were done. So the folks who are still working it out are still working it out, but they have 20 seconds. We'll be back shortly.
Can I ask you a question, Dasha?
Sure.
I love alignment and I participated, but I never did get my poem from someone else. I never did receive anything else.
Okay. The developer has been making tweaks every month. So there's going to be a flood of poems that's going to happen at the end of this month. Yes. So thank you for your patience in that. Getting a template and building a website from there. I've never built a website I didn't build anything. I told them what to build. So we're still working through some clicks. So you'll get them soon. But thank you for letting me know that.
If, I get the poems from one person or from everybody in that line?
You'll get them from one. You'll get one from one person. So for each prompt. Mm-hmm.
And then like he and I can write back and forth.
We don't. Thank you for that question. In my initial envisioning, that would have been lovely. Mm-hmm. But I wanted to build it in a way where people didn't, there was no reason not to participate. And there's someone who's going to think, what? An inmate is going to write me a letter?
Yeah.
Yeah. So it's not an experience where you'll write back and forth, but I'm sure there'll be a way for that to happen.
Well, I'm glad it doesn't actually for exactly the reason you said. It's just like, it would be interesting to receive the poem, but I didn't know what to expect.
Thank you for letting me know that. I wasn't sure. Yeah. So that's something I can follow up with. So you'll get a note from me at the end of this month when they had the final bug done. Thank you for that. Was not aware. All right. I think everybody's back. I was saying this last group had to call in union reps and do rock, paper, scissors to work it out. So what I'm going to ask is I can just ask the people who were, and I apologize for the language, at the bottom of the food chain. Can you hold up your critter to the screen so we can all see it? Who was at the bottom of the food chain in your group? Julian, you were so excited. Oh my goodness, I'm so sorry. So tell me what landed your critter at the bottom, Julie, please.
So my critter was from Mars, and so he came to Earth and he didn't really know what was going on. And so then he ate the mushroom donuts of the other critter. And so he got mad because that was his favorite thing to eat. So he ate me.
He ate me. What about you, Sarah? Thank you, Julie. What put your critter at the bottom?
It only lives until the sun goes down. And that could not compete with Mary's critter, who lives until the Packers win the Super Bowl.
That's some foreverness. No offense to the Packer fans, but definitely not before the sun goes down. So not the top of the food chain, but next in line. Whose critter was almost at the top of the food chain? If you can put yours up to the screen. Thank you, Angie. So what kept your critter from being right on top though? Tell us a little bit about that. You're muted.
It was according to what we ate. So mine ate cheese and there was a vegetarian below me.
So bookmark, that is my insert when I interrupt myself. I don't know how. So in my family, the first generation of cousins are now rising to, we're in charge of the family reunion. So we did it as just a little sample run last year. And then figuring out what the menu was gonna be, someone said, hey, what about the vegetarians? And cousin 12 said, look, vegetarians signed up to be disappointed at picnic. So we can't change things for them. So I'm so sorry, vegetarians, we all gotta get better. So what just happened is in your group, in this experience, we have just had an example of power. You were in a dialogue and a negotiation that agreed that the smallest, the lightest, the one that only lived the shortest amount of time, that those would be the critters that would perish first. And typically the ones that ate the most, lived the longest, were the most ferocious, those are the ones in the groups that typically are decided to thrive. And the way that power works, it doesn't make any sense as an intellectual person. Why would I absolutely work against my own benefit? But that's how power works, because it leans into the idea of a greater good. It leans into the desire for the group to create a system, a structure, a class organization that makes it easy for all of us to celebrate and move forward. So, and that's the same thing that happened when we showed up here. So as a society, as a culture, we have created a system of power that doesn't entirely make sense for everyone involved. But when we got here, similar to the way we have narrated, you have anecdotes of people that come from a dysfunctional family, in many cases can create their own dysfunctional families. Well, hello, America. We did the same thing. When we came over here from England, we brought the poor laws. We came over, we brought a class structure. We came over with an idea of who was worthy and who wasn't. And unfortunately, it was the people who had been deemed unworthy who came over here. And they brought those same ideas of land ownership, of wealth, of the baron class as a way to decide how we were going to build this new nation. And so class has been the infrastructure of how we built this incredible land that we live on. And so you think about, well, that makes sense. And the haves and the have-nots kind of work together, the have-nots trying to get to where the haves are. And once our first installment of slaves who were Irish acquired everything that had been promised to them to gain some of that have, they said, listen, landowning people, here we are at our bootstraps. My father was an indentured servant. I was an indentured servant. We've paid off our debts. We're ready for some of that land of milk and honey you talked about. And the have said, listen, great idea. We love to do that. But we need you to keep an eye on those Africans. Yeah, because they're going to threaten all this stuff that we're building. And the poor Irish, Scottish, like we, oh yeah. We're in this together. In that moment, we weren't German and French and Slavic. We were white because the baron class needed the people coming for what was their due to be distracted. So race was put in place as an invention, as a construct, to justify the we and the them. And in that moment, the landowning class, who are also our politicians and our decision makers, said, you know what, on top of that, we are never going to enslave you again, because the initial immigrants were enslaved in various forms. We will only enslave the Black Africans. How about that? And if we can do that, if you keep an eye on them, we will be all right. We can keep this thing together. And so in this moment, you have groups of humans in the same condition, poor sharecropping whites and poor enslaved Africans in the same economic experience, in the same social experience, and they bonded together. They tried to battle together. And the folks in power, the haves, broke that up and created a sense of, created another, a middle class status. And this became how we structured our movement forward. And today, the idea of race and class are conflated. The idea of race and class seem to be one and the same. And it's a whole other talk show and a whole other day about how and why we got to that point. But what's I want to point out here, nothing is more effective than having people point away at what they, and telling them their threats behind them. So they're protecting their back, instead of going up the hill to get what was their due, which is the idea of the haves having less, not a popular idea. So fast forward, here we are, and we are going through our diversity training and our cultural competency, and we have done all the things, all the trainings, all of the posters, and all necessary, yes, and all pretty reactionary, right? So the idea of having this dialogue is when women started coming to the workforce, and it was, okay, listen, let's do a training. You can't talk about her boobs. You can't mention her cleavage. I know. Let's have a training. And then Blacks came into the workforce. Let's do another training because you can't say chicken. I know. You just can't. LGBTQ. Back and forth, these different conversations, and all necessary, but you can feel in your spirit how it feels like a reprimand as opposed to an opportunity to figure out a way to be healthy moving forward. So my favorite is where the space of these inclusion trainings. Yes, inclusion. But inclusion by itself as a thing that feels like we should do always felt to me like Jell-O with the fruit in it. I hate Jell-O with the fruit in it. That random chunk of peach in the middle of this Jell-O texture. It's like saying, we see you over there praying five times a day against the greater Jell-O. All right, pineapple chunk with your same sex partner, you do that inside this greater Jell-O. So the idea and the reality in inclusion is acknowledging these differences while also communicating that there is a standard that was set way back when by you know who. So for me, the idea of thinking about how we move forward is thinking about how we move forward, how we rethink these rules that we've inherited, these conversations that we've never needed to interrogate. And I like to describe all of us right now in season 3 of a Netflix binge. We saw the cliff notes from season 1. We heard a little bit about season 2, but here in season 3, for real, all we know is we don't talk to those neighbors. We don't trust that music. We don't go to that side of town. This is just what it is. We don't even ask about it. And I like to always share that this is work that all of us are figuring out. And I still have a visceral reaction when I see someone with a camouflage baseball cap on. And I know it's ridiculous. And still, there it is. Now, do I respond to that? Do I act a particular way? I try not to, but I feel my body's tense. And if that, especially if it's a guy in a camouflage hat, and if he has the wraparound shades sitting on the brim, oh, I know he's dangerous. I know he hates to see me. And I don't have any experience with a guy in a camouflage baseball cap who's ever treated me any particular way, but there's something embedded in my knowing that I have to keep an eye on him. And we all are working through these things, these messages, these ideas that we don't even know where they came from. And because we don't think of them as foreign, we don't think of them as who we are. And Bill Burr, who's a stand-up comic, he has this line that I love. He says, you know, where we are in this conversation all depends on who taught you your ABCs. All depends on where you got your information from. So I'm an Army brat. I'm a really good friend of mine. When Colin first took the knee and we're arguing on Facebook, and she's like, I can't believe you. And I'm like, I can't believe you. And we have the same set of facts. Colin Kaepernick took the knee for Black men being killed by police with no reprimand. We agree that that's a fact. That's why he did it. It's what happened. Now, our two different truths. Kelly is like, my father is melting from Agent Orange. So to disrespect this song is to disrespect his service to this country. And DJ, I was DJ back in high school because my name, remember? DJ, you and I are military kids. My dad's Army, her dad's Navy. How could you not? I'm like, Kelly, because my dad is a Black man. So I want to interrupt this song and this game so he can go to the store and go home. So my husband can go to the store and come home. So we have two different truths and the same set of facts. So what happens is we find this conversation difficult because we're arguing with one another about our truths. You cannot tell me what my experience is. I can't tell you where your guilt lies. We can't agree about our life experiences, but we can have different conversations when it's not about being right, when it's not about shaming the other. It has to be about trying to understand all the stories that got us here. Because remember, you have no idea what the other person is thinking, where they've been, whether they're afraid of people who are wrapped in melanin, whether they're nervous around camouflage, whether they embrace everyone. We don't know, but we've all been conditioned to work in shorthand because that's how brains work. But all of us have the opportunity, especially in what we're watching explode around us, to pause and just ask little questions in yourself. Doesn't take a whole conversation. Just where'd that come from? And we're not going to get it right. We're not going to be perfect. But that's the beginning, that we all have our own truth. So if you look at your critter, this little beast that you designed, this little doodle, they all come from the same 4 animals. We all are impressed by the same 4 elements: power, class, race, and equity. Now, your relationship to power may be small. It might be just one spider eye. Your relationship to race may be enormous. It may be the entire critter body. But all four of those elements are part of your experience as a neighbor in this nation. And your story, your relation, what you have to say about that also matters. Because the other side of this problem, and the problem not where we are, but the problem being how we talk about it, is when we get together, if my role is to shame you, we did nothing. Because that's suggesting that I have nothing to learn and you have nothing of value because you're wrapped without melanin. And that is also ridiculous. So it's how we have the conversation different than what we're talking about. Because this what, y'all, we got to talk about it. We can't fix what happened, but don't you want to understand it? Aren't you curious what I think about? I'm curious what you're thinking about. I'm curious how you're processing. And just that effort of curiosity can be the salve to get us from here to something healthier and next. So I'm going to ask you, I'm going to put you back in your groups. No, not going to groups. I didn't do that well. In the larger session, this is a way that we start the dialogue. I would have Marilyn match with Brenda. Not right now, just as an example. Marilyn said, no. And you would talk, and you would go to the side of the room and the two of you would talking about your relationship with your truth, with power, with equity, talking about your doodles. What is the story of your truth? Because that's what the name is of your critter. On your page, that's your truth. That's your truth. And then the two of you would bond with Cy and Kevin and become a quad and talk about what you heard, what you learned, what you hadn't considered before, what you wish other folks would think about. And then a four would join the other four and become eight. And then the whole room is sharing where they have been nudged. We don't leave with any solutions, but man, we all leave whole with a doodle and a poem. So here's the best news. All those questions I asked you, put my truth in front of them. I think this will be my, while you doodle, I'm gonna play a little something from Sheboygan. Not that you don't get it, but like I said, I got prepared, so I'm playing everything. Oh, wait. Okay. Think about it, because I'm going to do something fancy. Watch. Is that happening? Do you hear anything? No? Try to be too fancy. So what I was going to play is the audio of the My Truth statements from Sheboygan. And these audio of these My Truth poems is how I end the My Cake show. This audio plays as the audience is hopefully applauding the show and definitely as they're filing out to get ready to eat cake and talk some more. See, not an art class. It's not just you. My truth. Take a moment and make your little notes, a quick poem. I'm minding the time. Have you do that? I'll do one poem and I'll take all your questions. Or no, I'll take your questions and maybe I'll do a poem. Man. Thank you. So the question that I asked, where was your critter discovered? What does it eat? How does it protect itself? Whatever those answers are, that is your poem. My truth was discovered in the dimple of a mountain. My truth eats raw fish. My truth protects itself by only climbing backward up a mountain. My truth, so that's how you piece it together.
Another minute, if you need a little more time.
Well, what the fruit it bears. What good is love that no one shares?
You don't have to end your piece, but if you can find a comfortable place to stop. At this time, I will take your truth poem. I will take your questions. I will take your winning lottery numbers. I will take your commentary, your critique. I will bring it all to me right now. What do we want to hear from the good people?
Dasha, one question we had from earlier was, what was the title of the first poem that you opened with?
Celestial.
Celestial, thank you.
Dasha, I have a poem, but I didn't write it according to your suggestions.
I just give you a place to start. How you land is perfect.
Here's my poem. Cake can have many shapes, flavors, colors. Cake can have many layers. It's the frosting that holds it all together. The icing on the cake is the binding of all humanity, the mixture of all life's ingredients, which we can all savor.
Most excellent. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. And a bit of really important trivia about the cake show. I don't bake like at all. I've tried it twice. It's not my ministry. So I learned into this research and the idea that that popped in my head as you were talking about that piece, Marilyn, as I know we'll keep tinkering with it. What I've heard bakers say, and the one cake I made where it went wrong, is the icing, the frosting that goes between the layers is what takes the most work. So as you develop that, if you bake, and if you don't bake like me, then this poem is not going to have a lot of cake references in it. But if you can lean into what makes frosting work, what makes cakery happen, I really love that as a where this piece could go. Not that you asked for an editing, but I just wanted to share that with you. Thank you for sharing that piece though too. Do I offer workshops for the public? I do. I try to, and I haven't in a really long time initiated workshop series as a way. I've learned, that's another side business. And going back to what I was telling Sarah, all the plates and doing 20 things at once, I'm really excited about creating the content so that when an invitation comes, I'm ready. And even better, I absolutely love the experience and the process of collaboration where XYZ company or agency says, hey, we're trying to, like this thing, how cake started. We want to do an engagement to get people talking. And then in working together, we'll create something. Because my skill and my excitement about imagining together, from creating art to imagining ways for people to engage like we just did, and also straight ahead writing workshops. I do enjoy doing it. So I've gone from trying to find ways to make it happen to being available when I'm invited to do that. So yes, I do. Typically it's a great organization like Shake Rag that brings me in. Another poem, another question.
I got a poem. Mm-hmm. This is Kevin. Four animals, four elements, four strengths, four words, for a glimpse of one truth to another. Curious only about what brought them there. Thank you.
That is the line that's going to save the planet. What brought them there? I can be curious about what brought you here and have all these kind of opinions about it, but curious about what brought me to sit in front of you. These words we put together, they're art, but they also, remember the spelling our spells? So we're putting things into the universe that will shift everything. I love that. Curious about what brought them there. And that them could be themselves or the other person. Okay, Kevin, I see you. I see you, poet. Have I written a poem about people imagining together? Not yet. Not yet. I would say anything would be close. I have some shorter pieces, the young people that I've worked with. So my time in being as a teaching artist, and that's similarly being invited to schools and campuses to do sessions like this or come up with longer programs. And for a bulk of my time in working and spoken word with young people, we did an intramural poetry slam league, which then gave opportunity to train those high school students to develop workshops, to become coaches. And then a lot of those young people have, they're staying my phone, they're leading nonprofits, they're earning Emmys, they're going down and causing all kinds of havoc at their city halls where they live, because it's invitation to imagine their voice and their words and their little poems as worthy, embedding them an audacity to get out into the world. So I have little pieces about them figuring that out, because in addition to their voice, they're trying to figure out how to be 19. So I had a fellowship that I created when I was like, let me get this straight. I have listened to you throughout high school write poems about every ism, and you're afraid to make a phone call? You don't know where the stamp goes. You don't, come on, we're gonna make expend the year
figuring out where you belong and what that gets to mean for you. So I've definitely, and I call them my sugar babies. So I have some pieces of just about how they figured out. And that's for anyone between 18 and 88, but especially that window between 18 and 23. I call that neo-grown, your grown-up internship. And having the pillars in that place makes the rest of the years a little bit smoother. Thank you. Oh, I appreciate that. Thank you so much. I am going to share one piece and let everyone get into their life. And it'll be a short one. Flow. Cement unwinds into the countryside. Chatter about bad days and impossible dreams. Twitters between the trees, between satellites, between granola and grits, leche and lumpia, between homecomings and homegoings, one and all. Dusk consumes the sun, dawn swallows the moon, triumph and tragedy pinned along the horizon, snap and fan in concert above the breeze, above shades of pumpkin and construction cones, concrete, ash, espresso shots, and hay. Monarchs dance before skylines of seedlings and steel, to the pulse of combines and shiny shoes, across landscapes rich and gorgeous with wild life, one and all.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dasha.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you
so much. It was great.
Terrific.
Thank you all for being wonderful as usual.
Thank you.
You got 8%.
Love it. Love it.
And we will have the recording of tonight's session with Dasha on our website this week. So if anyone missed it or you want to share it, you want to tell people what they missed, you can direct them to our website. And not too long, we'll be welcoming Laura to back to Mineral Point. So thank you for being here tonight, Laura. We'll see you soon. And thank you all so much, Dasha. Thank you for everything tonight. We're just so grateful.